by the promised land. Something better than what they were experiencing. Something greater. Something far better than they could have ever hoped for or dreamed for. 12 men go out. 10 men, you remember, come back talking about the giants. 2 come back talking about victory with God's help. By the way, can you name the 10 that decided not to go in? I can't think of one. But I'll bet you can name the 2 who did. Joshua and Caleb. A little shepherd boy named David goes out to visit his older brothers. Older brothers who are in the military, older brothers who are off at war, older brothers who know the importance of military gear, and how they try to influence him and encourage him to wear their special gear. David's pulling a little red wagon with lemonade, peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, possibly still wearing Superman underpants or something, I don't know. And he goes out to meet with his brothers who come back talking about Goliath, a giant that they're afraid to confront. While the little shepherd boy goes after him with a slingshot, talking about God. Same circumstances, totally different perspective. Max Lucado has written a book. I would encourage all of you, especially if you're going through a difficult time, a challenging time, Max Lucado's book called Facing Your Giants. Great book. In the first chapter, he talks about, in the 17th chapter of 1 Samuel, he talks about the number of times that David mentions the giant. In that entire chapter, do you know how many times he mentions those giants? You should know. 2. Mexicano then encourages you in the latter part of that chapter to list the number of times that David talks about God. Now, I know varying translations will give varying numbers, but Mexicano points out that David mentions his God 9 times. 9 times. Listen to what he says. I count 9 references. God thoughts outnumber Goliath thoughts 9-2. And then here's where the, you know, just that little dig comes in. How does this ratio compare with yours? Do you ponder God's grace 4 times as much as you ponder your guilt? Is your list of blessings 4 times as long as your list of complaints? Is your mental file of hope 4 times as thick as your mental file of dread and fear and worry? Are you 4 times as likely to describe the strength of God as you are the demands of your day? And if you're anything like me, it may not come out as high as it should. So many times we dwell on the negative, though. So many times we think about all the things that could go wrong, that might go wrong, instead of all of the times that God has brought us through in the past and the things he's going to do for us in the future. Now, it gives this great little quote. You might want to write it. It's awesome. I know it's great for you. Focus on giants, Max Lucado writes, and you're going to stumble every time. You focus on that giant, you focus on that negative thought, you focus on that anxiety, and you're going to stumble every single day, every moment of your life. But when you focus on God, and that's this, when you focus on God, and you read his word, your giants tumble. What a great, great quote. Focus on giants, you stumble. Focus on God, your giants tumble. While the little shepherd boy goes out after this giant with a slingshot, he's doing one thing. He's talking about and thinking about his God. And maybe that's something that all of us should be reminded of today. I want to go from Psalm chapter 36 to Mark chapter 4. And in Mark chapter 4, we find another example of where people approach the same circumstances from 2 very different perspectives, and the scene takes place on the boat. And you know the passage if you've been in church for any length of time. How many of you have ever spent time on a boat? Any of you? A few of you? Maybe when you think about spending time on the water, you might be thinking of a cold beverage in your hand, or wind blowing in your face, and Frank Sinatra tunes playing. I shared with the first crowd, if it was a younger crowd, we might have to put the Jonas Brothers or something learning on the speakers. But anyways, picture yourself on a boat in a perfect setting where you're thinking, life doesn't get any better than this. No trouble, no difficulty, no anxieties, no fear about the future. You're just in a place, a great place, where life is great, and all you can think about is, it doesn't get any better than this. And you've had moments like that in your life. But maybe when you think about a boat, you think about fishing gear. There are some people who love to fish, and they think about everything that is fish. So they spend lots of money on fish finders and depth finders and downriggers and trolling motors, and they'll spend anywhere from $4,700 to $5,200 on a pound worth of fish. You know what I'm talking about? But it doesn't matter, because you see, to that fisherman, life doesn't get any better than having that line in the water, no matter what the cost. So maybe when you think about being on a boat, you think about just relaxing. Or you think about fishing. Or maybe when you're on a boat, you think about life vests. Now, I say life vests because maybe you've never learned to swim. And when you get on that boat, the very first thing that you think of is, where's that life vest and which table can I hold on to for the entire trip? Bart and I had an opportunity to take my folks on a trip to Catalina. And if you've ever been to Catalina, many times when you go in the morning, the water's placid. It's perfect. It's calm. It's great. But when we came back over to the mainland, it was anything but calm. It was, in fact, the waves were so strong they were hitting. The boat was kind of diving into a trough and nosediving, and the wave was crashing up and over. And I remember looking over, I'm sorry, Mom, but I remember looking over my mom, and she was in fear. Panic-stricken state, because she never learned how to swim. So with every wave, she thought, this is it, we're going under. So for her, when she gets on a boat, she's thinking, life vest, God be with us, help us until we reach land and she can kiss the great earth. What do you think about when you're on a boat? In Mark chapter 4, Jesus and his close friends are getting into a boat. It's been a long day of teaching, a long day of ministering, and so Jesus decides to escape the crowds, to escape the noise, to escape the chaos, if you will, and evidently the first thing that Jesus does is fall asleep at the back of that boat. The waters, for those of you that remember the story, the waters are calm when they start out. Everything's going well, and all of a sudden there's a storm, the kind of storm where the wind is blowing and the waves are crashing, and it says that the disciples were afraid. And where's Jesus? He's back in the boat, asleep, it says, on a pillow. On a pillow. They can't believe it. And you know the story again. They're ticked off, and they start crying out to God, but he doesn't hear a word they're saying. It kind of reminds me of when I was a parent with little babies. And you'd have a baby crying in the middle of the night, and I remember sleeping right through it. Well, at least I pretended I was sleeping right through it. Jesus is asleep. You ever feel like you're in a storm and Jesus is asleep? You ever feel like, I've got a horrendous week ahead of me, and I feel like there is no God. I feel like there is no one to encourage me, to help me to get through this time. Jesus is asleep. The disciples are ticked off because it seems as though he is nowhere to help them. And they cry out, Teacher, do you not care that we're perishing? You ever said that? Lord, it seems like you don't even care that I'm perishing. It doesn't even seem that you care what I'm going through or what I'm having to face. And there's probably not one of us in here who hasn't said or asked those kinds of questions. Lord, where are you? God, how am I going to raise 3 kids all by myself? You don't care. Barb and I and some good friends of ours had the opportunity of helping a young lady who became a paraplegic because she was in an automobile accident, left 3 children, lives in a 2-story home. We were told that she hadn't been up in the second story in 2 years. Can you imagine 3 kids, all of them upstairs, and she's not had an opportunity to go up upstairs and see what those rooms must look like? You want to talk about Y2 chaos, that must have been amazing.